And the final section is disease. What's a disease? This is Fleck's question. And the same question appears to different rhetorical purpose in Richard Lewontin's Biology and Ideology, reviewing, as the Harvard scientist does, the standard claims of the great medical advances since supposedly wrought by scientific research. And he uses these advances to point out that other factors are inevitably at work in almost every instance where medical science prefers to take the credit. In Lewontin's case, the issue is a matter of rhetoric, as it is a matter of historical context, and thus public health confusions. At issue is Fleck's own concern with etiology, or disease causation. As Lewontin writes, intriguingly repeating, always without referring to Fleck, the same point Fleck himself makes, albeit updated for contemporary sensibilities and therefore in terms of the contemporary scientific thought style, this is Lewontin, any textbook of medicine will tell us that the cause of tuberculosis is the tubercle bacillus, which gives us the disease when it infects us. Modern scientific medicine tells us that the reason we no longer die of infectious diseases is that scientific medicine, with its antibiotics, chemical agents, and high technology methods of caring for the sick, has defeated the insidious bacterium. End quote. Now, Dick Lewontin is not claiming that the tuberculous bacillum is not connected with tuberculosis any more than Larry Loudon is claiming that everything and anything is science. Lewontin, instead, is pointing to the very problem of identifying disease as such, just as Fleck is doing in his own study of what becomes the Wasserman test and what becomes our collective identification of syphilis, a collective identification which has parallels with contemporary studies of AIDS causality and treatment. Heidegger's 1927, The Concept of Phenomenon, makes a similar point, converging with Fleck's own observations, he published that about 7 years later, Features of a Medical Way of Thinking, that last essay was published in the same year as Heidegger's own. Speaking about Krankheitserscheinungen, that is appearances or symptoms of a disease, Heidegger explains that by speaking of such Erscheinungen, such appearances, one has in mind certain occurrences in the body which show themselves, and which in showing themselves, as thus showing themselves, indicate, his word is indizieren, something which, I quote Heidegger, does not show itself. If Heidegger goes on to emphasize that, quote, this showing itself which helps to make possible the appearing is not the appearing itself, end quote, the point he seeks to make elaborates a hermeneutic articulation of Husserlian phenomenology. I quote, appearing is an announcing itself, das sich melden, through something that shows itself. Thus, circumstances make all the difference. And the often cited illustration, Heidegger himself speaks of the paraphenomenon or pseudo-appearance, that is the appearance as mere semblance. For Heidegger, I quote, in a certain kind of lighting, someone can look as if his cheeks were flushed with red, and the redness which shows itself can be taken as an announcement of the being present at hand of a fever, which in turn indicates some disturbance in the organism, end quote. It is, I believe, no accident for Heidegger, and he might well seem to have borrowed his illustration from Thomas Mann's 1924, which is even earlier, Magic Mountain. Alexander Nehamas, philosophy professor at Princeton, referring of course neither to Heidegger nor to Fleck, much less to Lewontin or Loudon, has examined the working of writerly irony in his comparative reading of Thomas Mann's Hans Castorp and Plato's Euthyphro, not to read as much between two heroes or anti-heroes as the case may be, but to look at how we as readers read. And hermeneutically, this is worth attending to. But just in order to do that, we need to look at the preconditions for attention. We tend to be caught up in our prejudices, our presumptions, our assumptions. Now, Nehamas, a good student of Gregory Vlastos, observes that all of us are persuaded that we know better than Euthyphro, from Plato's dialogue of the same name. But to the extent that Nehamas pays attention to the related art of reading in his book, The Art of Living, the problem of such better knowing turns out to be the problem of the art of reading, as it were, or what Nietzsche called a lack of philology, such that we miss the point, that perhaps, in this case, Plato, painting the point with such a sophomorically evident or broad brush, might have intended all along. Who is the more deluded, Euthyphro or the reader, who, after all, goes along entirely? In the case of the parallel example Nehemas gives us, pointing out that as readers, we attend to or follow the writerly direction given us, duly, uncritically accepting that the report of Kastrup's sensibility and the injury given to propriety, and hence the account of his irritability and associated pomposity, were distracted from what's also related to us as readers and at the same time. Quote, this is a quoting, this is Nehemas quoting Thomas Mann. The flush which had mounted in his freshly shaven cheek, die frisch rasierten Wangen, did not subside, nor its accompanying warmth. His face glowed with the same dry heat as on the evening before. He had got free of it in sleep, but the blush had made it set in again. As Nehemas, however, points out, what's at work in Thomas Mann here is a chillingly, as he puts it, writerly tour de force. What's most interesting for Nehemas is what the writer induces in the reader, as that is the same kind of self-duplicity evident in Kastorp himself. We know better than what we might read about the appearance of illness in the passage above, because we already have our own prejudicial interpretation of Hans Kastorp's appearance. Hans is flushed because he's shocked, dismayed, and angry. It's difficult to interpret his red face as the first symptom of the consumption that keeps him on the mountain and ultimately makes him, from one point of view, just like the rest of the patients, from whom, even at the end of the book, we will still be trying to distinguish him, and that's Nehemas. For Nehemas, this will turn out to be the function or hermeneutic efficacy of prejudice and self-pleasing conviction on the part of Kastrup and the reader. As we attend to Hans Kastrup trying to deceive himself about his neighbors at the outset of the novel, Nehemas explains that we manage to fail to read, an ironic failure that Thomas Mann inaugurates for us, and this is part of his writerly achievement. Quote now, we disregard his much more successful disregard of his tubercular symptoms. Our ignorance regarding Hans's illness is also ignorance regarding ourselves as well. In depicting self-deception in his character, Mann induces it in the reader. End quote. It's not an accident that the theme is tuberculosis, and as Fleck argues, where tuberculosis has a certain romantic appeal, syphilis has no such allure. Yet for Fleck and qua diseases, they're related, not least to the extent that just as we can ask, what's syphilis? It also turns out that we can ask, what is tuberculosis? And indeed, what is AIDS? To use a contemporary example, we might ask once again, invoking a disputed disease, not only AIDS is disputed, controversial to the extent that diagnosis is problematic, and treatment more so, what's Lyme disease? Thus, the biologist Lynn Margulis, whose signal discovery of the exogenetic origination of intracellular mitochondria invokes the famous case of Nietzsche's supposed syphilis in order to draw attention to her argument that syphilis has a variety of manifestations, seemingly replicates some of the complicated turns taken by the argument Fleck made for his own part in the genesis and development of a scientific fact. Of course, she doesn't quote AIDS. Of course, she's not talking about Fleck. She was unaware of Fleck's work, just as she was unfamiliar with the range of Nietzsche scholarship, even though she was writing about Nietzsche, and not just the popular accounts on the related question of Nietzsche's syphilis. Margulis's point, nonetheless, bears on Fleck's historical study of syphilis, Duisberg's questioning of the etiology of AIDS, as it is indeed to the tick bite and the spiral sheet and other associated bacterial components that are associated with clinical manifestations of Lyme disease. The spiral sheet itself, and Margulis's work on mitochondria makes her knowledge here very relevant, is an intrinsically compound and pleonastic entity, changing morphologically over time and in response to its environment. The same mutability makes diagnosis and treatment elusive, simply because the bacteria can change form, even escaping detection. Thus, late-stage manifestation of both syphilis and Lyme diseases, Margulis observes, tend to have dramatically devastating effects, while taking decades to develop, that is, what's effectively a lifetime, and producing symptoms in their end stages that are arthritis and muscular and mental enfeeblement, hard to distinguish from the simple effects of age. And moreover, even when diagnosed, hard to treat. Tuberculosis itself can be regarded from an epidemiological perspective as a fairly classical public health problem, one that can be solved in terms of morbidity and apparently on every level by public health measures, meaning better food, better sanitation, that is, fresh air and clean water, as Lewontin is at pains to point out. But that means that other factors are involved with morbidity, and these other factors are elements, causal, if one wishes to consider the fatality of disease, that are not counted into our assessment of the cause of the disease. Now I quote Lewontin, "The death rates from the major killers like bronchitis, pneumonia, and tuberculosis fell rather regularly during the 19th century with no obvious cause. There was no observable effect on the death rate after the germ theory of disease was announced in 1876 by Robert Koch. The death rate from these infectious diseases simply continued to decline, as if Koch had never lived. By the time chemical therapy was introduced for tuberculosis in the earlier part of this century, more than 90% of the decrease in the death rate from that disease had already occurred," end quote. I repeat Lewontin's first sentence as its key. The death rates from the major killers like bronchitis, pneumonia, and tuberculosis fell rather regularly during the 19th century with no obvious cause. The point has to do with public health records or statistics. Overall, death rates declined. Lewontin, I'm seeing almost probably getting the germ theory of disease here. Lewontin explicates this point further, taking up the broad issues of disease vulnerability, having to do with stress and nutrition and a host of other factors. Note that it's not Lewontin's concern to provide support for anti-vaccination movements, the folks worried that thimerosal preservative and other incidental ingredients in a vaccine may not be good for a child's health, and who caution against vaccination for this and other reasons, and so on. But instead, he begins by citing the efficacy of vaccination. But he goes on to point out that this is hardly as a result of or proving the success of vaccination. His point is rather the general attenuation of the morbidity of the disease as such. Quote, "At present, Canadian and American children do not often get measles because they're vaccinated against it. But a generation ago, every school child had measles, yet death from measles was extremely rare. In the 19th century, measles was the major killer of young children, and in many African countries today, it remains the highest cause of death among children. Measles is a disease that everyone used to contract, for which there's no known cure or medical treatment, and which simply stop being fatal to children in advanced countries." And he wrote that in 1991. For Lewontin, vaccination works, but as recently as his own childhood, measles wasn't a death sentence, whereas it was exactly a death sentence in the 19th century, just as it continues to be a killer in non-Western countries. The point Lewontin is making is immunological and complex, but no less precise for all that. As Lewontin writes, I quote, "There have been complex social changes resulting in increases in the real earnings of the great mass of people, reflected in part in their far better nutrition, that really lie at the basis of our increased longevity and our decreased death rate from infectious disease," end quote. The desire manifest in medical science to be able to claim the credit for this lowered death rate is understandable, but it is simply, and this is Lewontin's contention, inaccurate. The statistics don't support it. As an evolutionary geneticist, Lewontin's concern here is against those who hold with certain genetic causes for cancer and the like. Part of the reason Lewontin opposes this is because, as he knows as a geneticist, would know the difference between a phenotype and a genotype, and knowing the difference should already alert one to the complex of factors that influence health and disease. That is indeed, as the word pheno, this appearance showing you, already tells you, how the organism appears, its aspect, its look. Our tendency is to privilege the gene. For Lewontin, this is a manifestation of today's dominant ideology, as he puts it, the transfer, I quote him, of causal power from social relations to inanimate agents, end quote, and his point is that it doesn't matter whether the agent is bacterial, viral, or genetic. For Lewontin, as for Fleck, I quote now, social causes are not in the ambit of biological science, so medical students continue to be taught that the cause of tuberculosis is a bacillus, end quote. For Lewontin, and despite the massive amounts of money channeled in this direction, quote, we're assured that if we could only find those genes that underlie alcoholism or the genes that have gone awry when we get cancer, then our problems will be over, end quote. For Lewontin, this conviction ignores the complex role of money and other advantages that belong in the study of society, so often divorced from medical research. Where Lewontin also agrees with Fleck is in the ideological force attributed to hostile agency. And it is with this point that I return here to the reading of Fleck and his demonic characterization of bacterial, and we may add viral, infection. War. It's the conflict notion of scientific progress, a certain myth in which we remain pleased to believe to this day. Speaking of syphilis, to summarize here, the problem for Fleck was to trace its genesis together, altogether, and then to track and to follow its history. And for him, the problem there is that we project the contemporary notion of the disease back into the past, a bad faith project in any case, just assuming that science might continue to progress, and therefore assuming that the contemporary notion of the disease might itself turn out to be erroneous or incomplete or otherwise limited. Fleck, writing as a physician, was also concerned to explore just how a disease that changed its diagnostic profile, a syphilis, changes its presentation from a chancre that would be the diagnostic turf or disciplinary field of the clinical dermatologist to a disease of the blood in its putative secondary presentation. This would be Fleck's home turf of serology, to an infection spinal and cerebral fluid that affects the brain. And of course, this involves yet another set of medical specializations and concerns. As Stig Brorson glosses Fleck's analysis of the achievement of a serological test for syphilis, such a test as the Wasserman test translates, quote, an ancient proto-idea of syphilis as a change in the blood, alteratio sanguinis luticae. The point for Fleck in the prior listing of dermatology, serology, and neurology is that assumptions to such different thought collectives differ in their turn. Thus, a disease that crosses these disciplinary specialties can be especially pernicious, inasmuch as medicine, guild-like as it remains in its professional formation, can tend to be especially blind to such things. As a pioneer in leukurgy, that is, as a specialist in the cellular mechanics of immunology, it would do, so Fleck would ultimately argue, to be quite astounded that any fact at all, but especially such as syphilis and any diagnosis of the same, would be able to come forth as a fact at all. For Fleck, I quote, a historical connection thus arises between thought styles. In the development of ideas, primitive pre-ideas often lead continuously to modern scientific concepts. Because such ideational developments form multiple ties with one another and are always related to the entire fund of knowledge of the thought collective, their actual expression in each particular case receives the imprint of uniqueness characteristic of a historic event. End quote. The last thing that Fleck is saying is that there is no truth. Fleck is not Nietzsche and thought little of him. Much rather, Fleck's claim was a sociologically and historically informed ontico-epistemological claim. For Fleck, quote, truth is not relative, this is a quote, and certainly not subjective in the popular sense of the word. It is always, almost always, completely determined within a thought style. One can never say that the same thought is true for A and false for B. If A and B belong to the same thought collective, the thought will be either true or false for both. But if they belong to different thought collectives, it will just not be the same thought. It must either be unclear to or be understood differently by one of them. Truth isn't a convention, but rather one, in historical perspective, an event in the history of thought, two, in its contemporary context, stylized, thought constrained. End quote. Now, apart From the astonishingly Heideggerian force, very akin to the moves Heidegger makes in Being and Time, speaking about Newton and truth, of saying that truth is, quote, one in historical perspective an event in the history of thought, and two in its contemporary context, a stylized thought constraint, Fleck is concerned with metaphor, which, as we noted at the start, takes us to the necessity for a hermeneutic, if and to be sure, a hermeneutic phenomenology. Thus, hermeneutically speaking, we may note that the term relative, as Fleck uses the term, isn't to be conflated with relativism as such. Hence, when Fleck contends that a fact qua empirical is relative, he means that it's contingent or subjective to changing conditions rather than fixed or absolute. To these epistemologists trained in the natural sciences, for instance, the so-called Vienna Circle, including Schlick, Carnap, and others, human thinking construed as an ideal or thinking as it should be is something fixed and absolute. An empirical fact, on the other hand, is relative. Conversely, the philosophers previously mentioned with a background in the humanities construe facts as something fixed and human thought as relative. It's characteristic that both parties relegate that which is fixed to the region with which they're unfamiliar, quote unquote. That's Fleck. Hence it is that within this framework, what counts as syphilis, as Fleck analyzes it, will undergo transformations. I quote here, "The concept of a disease entity of certain micromycetes is an example of the pure culture and the connection between disease and microbes. It is as if their consistent application alone led to the discovery and no other concepts were possible. Truth is thus made into an objectively existing quality. Scientists are accordingly divided into two classes, the bad guys who miss the truth and the good guys who find it. This valuation, which is a general trait of exoteric thinking, was also created by the demands of the intra-collective communication of thought and subsequently reacts upon expert knowledge," end quote. I think it goes without saying, as Margulis implies in 2009, that the same claim might be made for AIDS research. Connecting the dots, which would allow me to retrace the steps vis-a-vis homeopathy, could also be made, but I bracket this here, as I have all along been bracketing cold fusion. I also think one can do the same with what we might call science and pseudoscience, philosophy and pseudo-philosophy, and so on. When Larry Loudon argues that, quote, "We ought to drop terms like pseudoscience and unscientific from our vocabulary," it's a good quote, I think. Part of his point, so I propose to read him hermeneutically with a good admixture of Nietzsche, but also with a sensitivity to the history of science, is that in garden variety fact, it can well turn out that we may learn, that we may make progress, which is to say, seen from this perspective, that the way that we currently fight disease may, perhaps, from a future perspective, turn out to be as wrong-headed or as primitive as the way we define it. Child of the Enlightenment and of the scientific legacy of the 19th century, as I happen to be, no less than either Nietzsche or Fleck or Feyerabend, I continue to hope for the possibility of progress that is a self-critical style of scientific thinking that is for me another word of questioning in philosophy and for revolutionary discovery in science. Thank you for your attention.